हाय,
हाय वेदिका।
सो वी आर बैक विथ अनदर सेशन ऑन रिफ्लेक्शंस। माय नेम इज वेदिका फणसळकर। आई एम करंटली परस्यूइंग माय मास्टर्स इन क्लिनिकल साइकोलॉजी फ्रॉम वीएस कॉलेज चेंबूर, एंड टुडे सेशन इज गोइंग टू बी रियली इंटरेस्टिंग एंड समथिंग दैट आई एम श्योर अ लॉट ऑफ पीपल वुड लाइक टू नो अबाउट। एंड टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू टॉक अबाउट एंगर एंड एंगर मैनेजमेंट। सो वी आर हियर अगेन विथ माई प्रोफेसर मिस असीरा चिरमुले। शी इज द डायरेक्टर ऑफ अथा सेंटर फॉर साइकोथेरेपी एंड ट्रेनिंग विच इज इन थाने इन मुंबई। शी हैज डन हर स्पेशलाइजेशन इन क्लिनिकल साइकोलॉजी एंड इज द एसोसिएट फेलो एंड सुपरवाइजर ऑफ रैशनल इमोटिव एंड कॉग्निटिव बिहेवियर थेरेपी फ्रॉम एल्बर्ट एलिस इंस्टीट्यूट न्यूयॉर्क यूएसए। She's also trained in CBT from Beck Institute for Cognitive Behavior Therapy, and she's also a Gottman leader. She's a consultant psychologist at Sunshine Wellness Center in Vasai and a visiting faculty at Vivekananda College of Arts. So Atha Center has introduced these FB live sessions with an inquisitive group of hosts who are passionate about working for mental health and well-being. These series of Facebook live sessions are called as Reflections, and the purpose behind this is to create a platform wherein together we can reflect, inquire, and contemplate for a greater common goal of enhancing mental well-being.
Yes, thank you so much, Vedika, for a very detailed introduction. And I would like to introduce Vedika, who is very passionate about this subject of psychology. And she's a very, very curious student and obviously a budding psychologist now. She's pursuing her master's in clinical psychology. It's a very, very demanding master's program, and she's almost clearing it. And she has always been very, very dedicated towards understanding many mental health issues, and has shown strong interest to also promote awareness in relation to mental health. So I'm really happy to have Vedika on board today for this fun-filled interactive discussion, right?
Yes, definitely. So, like I mentioned, we are going to talk about anger and anger management today. And the reason why I thought that we need to talk about anger more is because I often realize, see, anger is a universal emotion, right? All of us experience anger, but there are just times when you are not able to express your anger the way you want to, and in that process, the point that you were trying to make sometimes gets lost. So I think this should be a very interesting and fun session, and I'm sure that people are going to take back a lot of helpful techniques to and strategies to deal with anger and manage their anger effectively.
Sure. And let me tell all our viewers, this topic was selected by Vedika's preference. She wanted us to have this discussion on anger. That's why, we have named it as the birth of anger is the death of inner
Yes,
peace.
inner peace.
Right? So we can start and begin our session.
Okay, so ma'am, I feel we should start with knowing what anger is basically. So can you tell us what anger is and why is it that people get angry? What's the purpose behind the emotion of anger?
Yes, definitely. I think that is a good question to start with. See, anger, from whatever I understand, it is an universal emotion. We all do experience anger so many times in our lives also, almost on a daily basis, right? So it is a very, very universal emotion, but the difference, or what we are trying to highlight today here is how to nurture a healthy anger. So, Vedika, even in anger, if you look at, there are two types, or we can say that we can understand anger in two types. So one form of anger is really unproductive. It doesn't get us anywhere. It is self-destructive. So, you can call it destructive anger. But there is also another type of anger which is actually very constructive. It helps you to achieve your goals, and it also gives a lot of inspiration. Right, so I choose to understand anger as a universal emotion. There is nothing good or bad about it. But what we should definitely, all of us, try to focus on is how to construct inspirational anger, you know, if we can call it that, an inspirational anger, and how to minimize this destructive anger within us. So it's the whole fight between which anger we let rule. Do we let rule the anger which is going to help us, or, you know, the emotion of anger which is going to be detrimental to us, right? So there is no good and bad about anger, if that is what you were asking me.
Okay, but why do we need to manage anger? I mean, why do we have to be effective in how we manage our anger? Why can't everybody just be angry the way they want to be angry?
How I wish that we could have that kind of, you know, freedom. But see, at the cost of what again? So I think a very valid question by you, that why we need to manage it. Look at something here. Our own experiences of life can be an evidence for it. We many a times get into anger, which is so unhealthy and so destructive that we end up disturbing us the most. So it is like, you know, we are drinking the poison of anger and we want someone else to die. That is what we think, you know, when we are angry. But Vedika, that's so, you know, that is so detrimental and destructive to our growth. So one reason to why we should work on inspirational anger, creating inspirational anger is, if we don't do that, we are going to be self-destructive. In anger, we end up harming ourselves the most. And I'm not saying just mental suffering. Obviously, we mentally suffer so much because of our anger. But look at the physical disturbances it can create. Today, anger is also known to be a cause of so many physical illnesses. Right? So, it also impacts our efficiency and effectivity. Look at the times when you have been unhealthy, angry. Someone made a comment on you. You know, someone made a very crude and very critical comment about you, and you just lost your peace and calm. That person just bought you by his comment or by her comment, right? So why we should work on this constructive or inspirational anger is, if we do not, it is going to be detrimental to our growth, to our achievement of goals. We won't be able to manage our own mental balance. Right, we won't be able to be more concentrated and focused on what we are doing, right? Because many people are going to behave in a way which will be something that you may not like. So are you going to just throw off your anger all the time? That is the question here. And thirdly, and the most important point, I think, why we should work on nurturing inspirational anger and not destructive anger is, the cause of anger, we think that they are temporary, but they are not. So you think it is just for the moment that I insulted him, or I used a certain comment for him. You think that it is temporary, but that person is going to carry it. The other person might just carry it for lifelong and leave about the other person. This anger itself will leave remnants of guilt in your mind. You'll be again guilty about what you said, because generally in unhealthy anger, we do not say pleasant things. So you'll be guilty. So now you have anger and guilt both to work at. And then you also might be hurt. Right? So it is like, you know, we keep on building our mental issues because of this anger. So if we are really interested to create toxins within us, then I think we should focus on maintaining unhealthy anger. But if you don't want to create your own toxins or your own toxicity, then we should try to move towards inspirational anger.
Okay. So what I understand from this is that we cannot completely take away the emotion of anger from us, but we can experience it in such a way that it doesn't have control over us to drive all our reactions which are unhealthy. Is that correct?
Yeah, well said. So it should, you know, the anger should not try to control you. That's right. That's exactly the point here. And I think we have some viewers. Yes, hi, Ruhi, Gayatri. They are all up putting some comments. And yes, thank you, Vaishali.
Okay. So what happens if we don't manage this anger well?
So yes, the fact that I was answering this, that if we do not manage this anger well, you are going to first cost yourself the most. You will lose your peace and tranquility and your, what you say, balance of your own mind, one. So it's going to cost you in that way a lot. You know, and I would like to read out one quote by, you know, by Swami Vivekanand. And I think it resonates so well with me, you know. He said that when I am angry, my whole mind becomes a huge wave of anger. So I'm no more just angry for a certain period of time, but I'm overwhelmed by that anger. Means just look at it, how much we are trying to get drowned and overwhelmed by this anger. And there's one more interesting quote by Swami Vivekanand where he mentions very clear about, you know, what he thinks about anger. I'll just read out the quote. As soon as we react, we become slaves. Just look at it. As soon as we react to someone's rejection, to someone's unpleasant comment, we become slaves to that person. We become a slave to that person. A man blames me and I immediately react in the form of anger. A little vibration, you know, is now, a little vibration is created and I am a slave to that vibration. So this is so important for us to understand that do we want to conquer our own anger or do we want to get conquered by someone else's comment? And this is the impact that anger has on us. It just overwhelms us. It overpowers us. We lose our discrimination. We are not able to think objectively, right, when we are angry. I remember there was one incident someone shared with me that just some rejection by his boss. You know, he gave an assignment or some, project and the boss rejected it because the boss really didn't find it interesting. And this guy couldn't control that rejection. That rejection became so, so important. He got identified with that rejection, right? And he got so angry that he just lost his control and he met with an accident. Just after the entire meeting, he was coming home and he met with an accident, right? God's grace, that guy is doing fine. But this is what anger can do. You just lose your, you know, concentration. You lose your focus. It hampers your discriminatory power to discriminate what is right and what is wrong. You get deluded by anger. So I'm not like an expert in understanding anger. I'm still, even I'm trying my best to get some insight into anger. But it clearly is quite self-destructive. That's the main point why we should work on anger.
So when we give undue power to it, I think it kind of takes over instead of who you are as a person.
Yes, instead of who we are as a person, and also when we are not able to manage anger, you know. So it's just about how to be angry, how to be angry in an inspirational way. That's what we are going to now, you know, tell our viewers also.
So, but when people are not managing their anger effectively, what are the kind of strategies that they are using, you know?
See, most of the times when they are not able to manage anger in a healthy way, they get into many such, you know, harmful strategies, like, for example, insulting the other person or abusing the other individual or, you know, just throwing some objects at the other individual. Or the most important strategy that people use is abusive behavior and abusive words. Instantly, those can come out. So you are becoming abusive towards someone. You're not able to understand the importance of that person in your life during that time. You're also being self-destructive and destructive for others. So you throw things, you insult someone. And in anger, you must have seen many of the times some individuals take impulsive decisions under the context of anger. So even impulsive decision making people get into, which is very, very harmful strategy that they use. Anger can also lead many individuals to get into addiction, different forms of addiction, or alcohol, smoking. There's so many forms of addiction which also are influenced because of not because of their inability to understand how to manage anger, right? So clearly we get into a lot of harmful strategies when we don't know how to manage anger. So I've pointed out just some. There are so many more. You know, one form of unhelpful strategy which recently, you know, I was working with a client, and that was so common, is also violence. Domestic violence is so common now. And sometimes at the basis of domestic violence, there also can be mismanagement, or, you know, not understanding how to manage such a powerful emotion like anger.
So from what I know is, you know, people, there are some people who are actively express their anger, and then there are some people whom we call as passive aggressive. So is both of it equally unhealthy if not managed effectively?
Yeah, that's a good question. See, definitely passive aggression is what? That there is some form of anger, but you have not yet translated it into specific actions. There are very, very subtle actions, but still it is it's a form of unhealthy anger only, even passive aggression. And you need to understand how that passive aggression is impacting you. See, the client, the person who does it, like, for example, if I am being passively angry towards you and I stop taking your calls, you know, that is one way passive aggressive individuals can also, you know, respond, that maybe I don't answer your calls at all, or I don't respond to only your messages. We need to understand that these actions are impacting even that person who is indulging the most. Not even that person is getting in, you know, what you say, affected the most, Vedika. So it's like he or she shows that they're not impacted, but their entire thought is getting consumed by you, is getting consumed by the other person, though in a passive way, but still there is an impact. And whenever, see, anger is destructive when it has an adverse impact on you, on your lifestyle, on your mindset. Then you need to really work on your anger. If it is impacting your mental balance, if it is impacting your goals, if it is impacting your, you know, your relationships with others, then you need to really work on it.
Can you give us an example of, like you mentioned, it might come in between your goals and daily life as well. So can you give us an example of how people don't effectively manage their anger and it comes in their way and their work or just life?
Yes, I can give example. One example I would give from one of the clients that I am working with, and, you know, very, very, you know, experiences anger a lot. Actually, he's a father, and, you know, maybe 45 years old or something. And specifically, the trigger for his anger is son. His son doesn't behave well with him, disrespects. So that's the trigger. So remember, every emotion of anger is related to a trigger. There are triggers in your life which provoke you. So the trigger is anything that is unpleasant. So for this father, it's quite unfortunate. But for him, you know, his son doesn't respect him, is very disrespectful towards him. And that really triggers his anger. And when this client gets angry towards his son, he just lashes out, criticizes in public. Like, there is a social gathering in their family, and this father is criticizing his son in front of everyone. So he uses which strategy to manage his anger is criticism. He keeps on criticizing his son, one. Second, alcohol. He also is experiencing issues with managing alcohol addiction. So whenever he gets angry, just to cool down immediately, he will have a peg or two. So alcohol is one of the strategies that, you know, he might use to deal with his anger. So one is criticizing. Second is alcohol. Third is also sometimes he self-harms. He beats himself up. or he just closes and is in his own shell. He doesn't talk with anyone for many, many hours. And there is self-harm also, that he beats himself up. So these are the three destructive ways in which he's trying to express his anger. And interestingly, Vedika, what maintains anger? You know, why this client is getting angry is because, you know, that disrespect that the son gives him, he gets identified with it. And he thinks that he's a disrespectful person. And that is also, I was just coming to that one of the reasons for why we get angry is we take comments by other individuals too personally, and we make them our identification. We make them our definitions. We get described by those unpleasant comments.
So he basically feels that the disrespect that he is getting is valid, or he is somebody who deserves to be disrespected.
No, he doesn't feel that. He doesn't feel that he deserves to be disrespected. He thinks that because my son thinks I am disrespectful, maybe I am a bad human. Maybe I am a bad father. So he is identifying with that, you know, opinion of his son. Though in his mind, he knows that that's not what I am.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, what happens? He gets identified and then he blames his son. That you are a fool. You are foolish. So then he ends up harming him also, harming his son also. So his son is labeling him as disrespectful. This father is also labeling his son as foolish. So that's how it continues. Mm-hmm. So from this example, what I would like to point out is, one, every emotion of anger, any emotion, specifically today because we are talking about anger, is related to some triggers. There are some unpleasant events that affect us.
Mm-hmm.
But how we react to them is in our control. So with this father, that's what I'm working on. With this client, that is what we are working on, is how to not get identified with those opinions.
Mm-hmm.
How to go beyond those opinions.
Okay.
Are you understanding this?
I do. And you mentioned that in this one case, it was disrespect that was a trigger. But what are the different kinds of triggers that can contribute towards feeling angry and being aggressive?
Right. There are so many triggers. You know, there are, one is obviously such opinions. So unpleasant opinions. This also can be one trigger. Second is any kind of rejection. If someone leaves you, if someone blames you, any kind of rejection or any kind of blame can also be one of the most common triggers to anger. Another trigger for anger is also, you know, when someone is not able to understand you. So someone is not able to understand me, or someone is not acknowledging my perspective.
Mm-hmm.
So lack of respect for my opinions can also be one of the triggers. Someone is not being respectful towards my vision or towards my opinions can also be a trigger for anger. But remember something, at the base of anger is, again, see, when any of your desire is not getting fulfilled, see, unfulfilled desires lead to anger. So you have certain desires about something, like, for example, I might have a desire that, you know, I should get 65 viewers today for this live session. If I have this strong desire that I should get 65 and there are only 34, let's end this meeting. This is useless to give my time to only 34 viewers. So if I have any such desires which are not getting fulfilled, they're getting obstructed, then it is likely that I will feel more angry.
Okay.
Right?
And, you know, once you feel angry, it is not just limited to that situation. I feel that emotion kind of spills over so many other areas of your life, that you keep continuing feeling angry, not just for the moment when that situation has happened, but also for hours probably later after that moment has passed. So then what are some thinking styles or factors that lead to this continuation of anger that happens?
Yeah, and that's a very, very specific question that you have asked, that we feel angry because of our thinking patterns, not because of the triggers. This I would really like to mention to all our viewers, that triggers definitely will introduce to your anger. Okay, you can get angry. Okay, Asira, you can get angry because of these factors. But what will definitely maintain your anger is what you think, or what meaning you give to those triggers. So there are three. I have like tried to give a capsule to all our viewers. There are major three unhealthy thinking styles that we can engage in, which actually maintains our anger. So if our viewers are interested to know why I feel angry, understand that you might be getting into either of these three thinking patterns. The first is insisting that your desire must get fulfilled. So insistence that whatever I have thought, I think that Vedika must understand me. If I have this relentless, rigid insistence, and if she doesn't understand me, I'm going to get angry because of my insistence on my desire from Vedika to listen to me and respect me. So please don't get me wrong. I'm not saying that you should not have desires. You can have desires, but do not turn them into, do not be insistent upon that they must get fulfilled.
Fulfilled.
Right? So this is the one most common thinking style which maintains anger, one. Second is that you're obsessed about your own self. Means what? You're obsessed about your own point of view to be right always. It's also very common in anger. Mostly we feel angry because we think that only our point of view is right, and we go and we stick by it. We have this weird obsession that whatever I have said must be followed, or whatever I have said needs to be taken into consideration, my point. So this obsession over my point of view to be right or to be listened to always can also create anger.
I can relate with this point that you mentioned, you know, because there are often times when you're trying to work on something and you suggest some ideas to people and they probably don't see it the way you do, but still you feel that, maybe they don't like my idea, or they are not listening to me, or they are rejecting my idea. I think that is something that really resonates with me now that you mentioned what the underlying thought pattern is.
Yeah, so that is, as you very rightly said, that this over obsession that we have about our ideas, my vision, my values, we have to be very flexible about this and not be so rigid about our views or our opinions. You can follow them in your life, but you can't really pressure someone else to also go by them. You know, you might think it is a very brilliant idea, but the other person might think it's really a very bad idea. So the third thinking pattern here is, we are not problem-based. We don't do problem-based evaluations. We do person-based evaluations. So Vedika, if for example, Vedika is giving some idea and I'm like, oh, she's so stupid. This idea is like, you know, anyone can think of this. I wanted something more innovative. So I made an evaluation of you. Now that is why, you know, anger will rise. So whenever you have a conflict or disagreement or you have any arguments, do it problem-based and not person-based. We easily get into person-based. And I'm saying we because all of us do that.
That's or I might feel that because that person did not take my idea into consideration, that person just doesn't want to listen to opinions. Sometimes that is what really ends up happening.
Yeah.
That so I start evaluating that person rather than their decision at that point.
Right. And that you made a good sense here. Their decision at that point means, again, it is problem specific and not person specific. So if someone is not agreeing with you, don't think that the person is not liking you or that person thinks you are not a good person. Nothing like that. Just think about it as a problem based evaluation.
Okay. So at this point, should we look at some of the questions that people have asked? So Ayushi Shah asks here, hi ma'am, how to control or manage unhealthy anger?
Right. So maybe I can give her some tool which will help her. Probably.
Yes.
So I think Vedika, we also have some strategies. I think I might include that here in her question. So hi Ayushi, yes. Thank you for your question. What I can help you here with, I think there's a good word you used, manage unhealthy anger, because it need not be controlled. Now, how to manage unhealthy anger, Ayushi, what we can do is, you know, I can give you a simple technique called as cool technique. COOL. This is for all our viewers. I tried to just, you know, make this technique so that we remember it. COOL. So what does the C stands for? So whenever you get angry, the first thing is to you should do is, for the C, look at the cost of this anger. What are the costs of this anger on me, on my health? So this is the first technique. Look at the cost of this anger on you. C. The second O, the O here in the cool, the O here is for open your ears for other people's point of view. See, in anger, when we are angry now, we are hell-bent on only our point of view. That my point of view is right, or you should only listen to that. That's why in this technique, we are saying that open your ears to other people's point of view. See what they have to say. Listen to their perspective also. So the C stands for costs of your anger. Think about the costs of your anger. O stands for open your ears to different point of views. The next O is overcome this self-obsession that we have. I was just talking about overcome this self-obsession that I am big, I know it all. So this self-obsession, in short, is I know it all syndrome. I don't know whether such exists, but this is just something that I made up right now. I know it all syndrome. That we many of the times we think that, see, I've done a PhD in this, so now I know everything of it. So then why I should listen to them and get some help from them? Not like that. There's so much more to know about your own subject also. We just know little. So the second O is for overcome the self-obsession that you know it all. Even in situations, we think I know everything. I know that he's wrong and I know why he did it. But we don't know exactly why he said what he said, what state of mind that individual was in when he said that. So I remember this client that I was sharing with you with about the father who experiences anger. Later we understood that his son actually feels very hurtful about his father's comments. And that's why he keeps on disrespecting. Actually, he's seeking love from his father, but that he's not getting. And the father is really being very, he's using a lot of harsh words, which impacts this son. And it's like a cycle that has been created now. Right? So the second O, as I said, is overcome the self-obsession. And the L, this L is very important. The L here is label each other's mistakes. Do not label them. So label mistakes of each other. Label mistakes means what? Like, you know, in this father's case, we really developed this technique where when the son is being disrespectful, don't call the son bad. Instead, say that the son is disrespectful. That is a bad quality. The son is not bad.
Mm-hmm.
He is having bad qualities. So you understand the difference between bad quality versus bad person.
Right, right.
That's why the L is label mistakes and not individuals. So this is a cool technique which will help you cool down when you are very, very angry. I hope this helps, Ayushi.
I think this was a really cool technique of, managing anger. Like you said, we shouldn't use the word control, but rather manage anger. And you know what I understand from what you said just now, the keyword here is specific. You know, at specific point of time, a specific mistake, maybe a specific opinion and a specific behavior, and not generalization of people and who they are.
That's great. That's true.
And do you think that you could tell us some more tools or techniques that some more cool techniques?
I think two, three, I will say what could be some Gaurangi. Hi, Gaurangi. She has anyway asked one question. What can be the right way to let out anger so that it goes towards healthy anger? Yeah, this question, I think, Vedika, I can answer. So,
Yes.
how you can express your anger healthily, if you are saying, most important thing is try to listen to the other person's story also. Don't just keep on, expressing your story. So the simplest way to let out your anger in a healthy way is ask the other person also for his views. One. Second is when you are expressing anger, use a lot of I statements. I think I've said this in my previous live sessions also, that the effect of I say messages or I statements, take responsibility for your anger because you are maintaining it. So I think you did not respect me when you said this, when you said that, whatever it is. I think you are ignoring me. I think you are acting in a very indifferent way. So take responsibility for your own views and your own feelings. And that is very, very important. That is one. Third is try to look at the problem, with the aim of solving the problem and not winning the problem. So winning versus solving. We should not try to win the problem, but we should try to solve the problem. What can be done to manage our our differences today? So look at some solutions. And when you are looking at solutions, again, look at both the parties' solutions. You also give two solutions from your side and even ask the other person to give and come to some midway. Midway has to be there from both the parties. It can't be only one way. This can be some strategies to let out your anger, healthily. And obviously, the most important is do not use emotionally loaded words. Do not use abusive words. Try to keep your voice firm and, and soft as much as possible. I know sometimes even when we are angry, we just go to the high pitch, but at least be aware and come back. See, I'm not saying that we are all best in managing our anger. We have to just build awareness, and that will only come with these constant reminders. And that's why we have these sessions, which are like constant reminders for me and for all of us.
True, true. Thank you so much, ma'am, for answering our questions and giving us tips on to how to deal with and manage anger effectively. I think all of us are going to take it back and try and implement in our lives. I know I am going to. There is one question that I feel is, has a common theme across a lot of questions is how do we express our anger effectively in such a way that even we feel satisfied that our side and our point of view has been heard, but at the same time, you don't harm the other person as well, because sometimes the intensity of your anger is probably not something that the person in front of you may have the capacity to endure.
See, again, as I said, some of the techniques I already answered when I was talking to Gaurangi. But as you said, if we have to express anger in a healthy way, we have to first, as I said, we have to first identify those three thinking patterns and cool them down and use the cool technique first and then communicate. See, if you are angry and you then start communicating in your anger, then you will end up harming more than doing any good. So you have to first cool down using the cool technique given to you and then respond to the other individual. And when you are responding, don't get into accusatory language. Try get into a language which is more expressive and which will tell him that you are just pointing out your understanding. So again, as I said, I think, so my thoughts, it's not you made me angry. We generally say this, you made me angry. But it's not true. I got angry by your comment. I got angry by your unpleasant comment. So I take the responsibility for anger, one. Second is share your reasons also what made you angry? So you can share your reasons. You know, I really felt angry because I thought it was very insensitive of you to bring this topic up today. So again, I'm taking responsibility for my views that I thought it was insensitive. I'm not saying that you are insensitive. See, there's a difference here. So even if you follow these two strategies, Vedika, I think you will do more good to the conversation.
Okay. All right. So yes, definitely. I think I am going to try and employ these in my daily life, and I'm sure other people who have been present here to listen to our series also will. So that is it for our anger session. Is there anything else that you would like to mention about?
Yeah, I think we have 2-3 questions here. I just will go through them quickly. They should not feel that I have not addressed. Shreya, Ishwari and Vrushti, you guys have very big questions. But I will just see what you are saying. Hi, Shreya. Can anger be a manifestation or a way of expression of other suppressed emotions? Both. To answer this, in short, it is both. It can be its own independent anger, or definitely there can be a lot of other suppressed emotions like hurt. Hurt is very common, which can go unnoticed. So hurt can be a very common suppressed emotion. Sometimes anger can also result. One of the reasons could also be anxiety. Right, Shreya, even that could be. So yes, to answer your question, it can exist independently also. And there can also be a lot of unresolved issues or emotions. Okay.
And continuing with Shreya's question, do you think that these suppressed emotions and a combination of anger kind of enhance and intensify what we've been feeling already?
Yes, it can. It can very well do that. That's why some individuals who are really not able to manage their anger by themselves, they should seek psychotherapy and get some help. Get some systematic help on addressing these unresolved issues. There could be so many unresolved issues, which might be in the past, some might be in the present also, right? So those need to be addressed. Otherwise, it can become another issue altogether. Ishwari has a question here, Vedika, that how can we make sure that we express our anger, feel content about having expressed it completely? Yeah, I think this you asked me, Vedika. Yes. So I think thank you for that. And Vrushti is asking, how can we convert our unhealthy anger to inspirational anger when the expectations of our closed ones is just too much? And failing to do so, they start blaming us even after explaining them about the boundaries. Yes, it's very, very true that many of the times this can happen, right? So you can turn it to inspirational anger by channelizing your anger in creative ways. So if they are not understanding you, right? Or if they are having certain expectations and for you, those are not important expectations, I think you can work according to what you think of yourself, Vrushti. You can work with reference to what your expectations are. Don't get bogged down by their expectations. People will have so many expectations from us. We might be at the top of our game, yet people can have so many more expectations. So that is a natural tendency of even our behavior. Even we have so many expectations from each other. So what we need to understand is how much I can do. And if I know now I cannot, I cannot maybe achieve those expectations. Whatever I can, I'm going to do and I will remain content with it. So again, Vrushti, this is your responsibility to become content. Even if others are not happy with your with your achievements or with your functioning. Sometimes you cannot make everyone happy also, right? So this is very, very important that you set your own boundaries and you try to follow those expectations for yourself and define the line for you. That doesn't mean the other people will understand and, they will try to, sync well with you. That may not even happen. But that is not the goal of managing anger. We are managing anger for our mental tranquility, not for their mental tranquility. I think this is what I would answer. So thank you all the viewers today. So many good questions, insightful questions. And we have extended our time, but that's fine. I think we were more excited than you were.
Okay.
You know, I would like to tell all our viewers that please, please stay updated with our page. You can please subscribe to our page, Psychotherapy at Athar, on Facebook and on Instagram, Athar Psychotherapy. We are going to have a lot of these pocket-friendly webinars for all of you. Our first webinar, you know, we are coming with a series called as Journey Within. And I have a great team with me who is working with me with reference to this community mental health project. We have this community mental health project coming up. We have called it as Journey Within. And in this Journey Within, we are coming up with a lot of webinars for enhancing awareness about mental well-being, so that we all can develop this mental, balance and mental well-being. So our first webinar is going to be on 9th August. Sadly, it's full. We are full with the registrations. The first one is a free webinar, but the second one is going to be on 23rd August. I'm releasing it today only in our talk, Vedika. The second webinar is going to be on 23rd August, and the topic is Power of Resilience and Compassion During Crisis. So during this crisis times, what is the power of resilience and compassion? It is an hour webinar. I have a great team with me. My team consists of Ishwari, Vrushti, Shreya, Madhura, Prajakta, and Sanika. These six people are there with me on the team. And we hope to grow this team also. They are all working very hard. So I would definitely like you all to register for this 23rd August webinar if you are interested. We will send the link and everything soon. It's a pocket-friendly webinar, so it's not at all expensive.
Yes, ma'am. I'm sure all of us are, going to sign up for all of these webinars that you host, because they are so informative and, you know, it answers a lot of questions and it has a lot of relevance in our daily life.
Okay, yeah.
So I know I am looking forward to these, and I will be keeping my eye on the Athar page. I hope everybody here who is present also does.
Yes, I'm sure they will. And thank you so much, Vedika, for your time today. It was always, it's a great pleasure to have so many, passionate students I have got the opportunity to be with. I really thank all of you for coming today, and we are sure to do more such interesting projects with all of my great, students and participants.
Thank you, ma'am, for giving us the opportunity.
Yes. Okay, bye guys. Take care.
Bye.